Welcome to the IISS this afternoon for a special session on civil society in Jammu and Kashmir, democracy versus terrorism. My name is Rahul Roy Chaudhary. I'm the Senior Fellow for South Asia at the IISS. This is a timely session. Next month, Jammu and Kashmir goes to the polls, along with the rest of India, for parliamentary elections. This serves to build on assembly, municipal, and panchayat village council elections held in Kashmir in the past 4 years. At the same time, there are calls for early assembly elections following the withdrawal of support by the ruling Bharatiya Janata Party, BJP, to its coalition partner, the People's Democratic Party-led state government of Kashmir in June 2018, resulting currently in president's rule in Kashmir. Last month's suicide bomb attack in Pulwama was the worst terror attack in Kashmir. This led to the highest level of tensions between India and Pakistan in nearly 2 decades, when, according to the international media, the two countries almost came to the brink of war. Alongside, civil society in Jammu and Kashmir has been gravely impacted from decades of local misgovernance and Pakistan-based sponsorship of terrorism. Since July 2016, violence has also intensified. According to the IISS Armed Conflict Survey 2019, nearly 500 people died in conflict-related incidents in 2018, making it the deadliest year for Jammu and Kashmir in a decade. Last month, the Indian government banned a prominent and long-standing Kashmiri separatist group, the Jammu and Kashmir Liberation Front, on the basis that it was, and I quote, supporting and inciting claims for the secession of a part of the Indian territory from the Indian Union and supporting terrorists and separatist groups fighting for this purpose. A few days earlier, India had also banned the Jamaat-e-Islami of Jammu and Kashmir. Today's panel on Kashmir will therefore focus on several key issues, including governance, radicalization, separatism, terrorism, media, and regional security. The objective is to look forward, not backwards, towards opportunities for political and regional stability. We are delighted to have 3 well-known panelists for this discussion session. Our first speaker, Lieutenant General retired Syed Atta Hasnain, is one of India's most decorated military officers. He retired in June 2013 as a military secretary after 40 years of service in the Indian Army. He has had 7 tenures of duty in Jammu and Kashmir, including serving as the General Officer Commanding 15 Corps with headquarters in Srinagar from 2010 to 2012. Our second speaker, Dr. Shabir Chaudhary, is the President of the Foreign Affairs Committee of the United Kashmir People's National Party. He was one of the founders and former president of the Jammu and Kashmir Liberation Front, which, as I mentioned just now, has been banned by the Indian government. Our third speaker, Nitin Gokhale, is one of India's leading strategic analysts. He's a well-known author and founder of the influential defense-related and strategic affairs websites BharatShakti.in and Strategic News International. I've requested all 3 speakers to provide brief introductory remarks for a maximum of 10 to 12 minutes each, which will be followed by a discussion session. General Atta Hasnain.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Pleasure to be back here at the IISS. I'm coming back to London after a fairly long time. I was at the RCDS and we used to keep coming here in those days very often. It's a great institution. Since I have very little time, let me get down to the subject itself. But I must at the outset give you a little bit of a sensitization. I will be speaking a lot of things which lots of you are not going to like, right? But it's nothing personal. These are issues which are we consider as reality in India, and there may be perceptions which are very, very different from the other side in Pakistan. We are always willing to accept that and listen to it. I am a part of the Track 2 process with Pakistan. I meet lots of generals and lots of diplomats from Pakistan. They are great friends of mine. I'm going to meet them on the 16th, 17th of April next month again. So I've been with Aisha a couple of times. I can see she's here. It's good to see you, Aisha. Let me start by saying I think there are too many misnomers on this whole issue of Jammu and Kashmir. I think it starts from 77. I don't like to take it back to 48. A few issues which I'd like to flag. 77, not many people know anything about what is called the Ziyad Doctrine. What was the Ziyad Doctrine? Primarily a retribution for 1971. What were the constituents of the doctrine? Primarily a method of targeting India and looking at India's prime weaknesses. And among the prime weaknesses was the whole issue of fault lines. I'm willing to speak about it if anyone wants to know more about it. The weakness of the Indian state in 1989, we were at our worst, we were at our weakest stage in 1989 when the whole issue erupted. From all domains, militarily we had 100,000 troops in Sri Lanka that year. Politically, the government at the center was completely unstable. Socially, we had the Mandal agitation on our head. Financially, we had $1 billion left in our coffers. And diplomatically, the world was in a tizzy with the Berlin Wall having fallen at that time. So everything was wrong, and that was the right, most appropriate time for Pakistan to actually launch what it did in Kashmir. And hats off to them the way they did it, very professionally. So the way we look at it, it's not an internal conflict. It's not an insurgency. It is hardcore proxy war. And that's the way I look at it, is proxy war. Sponsored, non-state. There's no such thing as non-state here. It is all sponsored non-state. Infiltration, local recruitment. Local recruitment could not last out. And therefore, there was the initial efforts of getting mercenaries across from Afghanistan. And that is how it carried on till 96. Thereafter, it was the Pakistani content which started coming in. The Lashkar-e-Toyba, the Al-Badr, the Harkat-ul-Ansar. And by 2001, we had the Jaish-e-Mohammed, the JEM, which is, as you see, what's happening today in 2019. This is, besides being a proxy war, it is a hybrid conflict. Please understand, there is no such thing as conventional war in the world today. Everything is hybrid. And hybrid needs a response with hybrid. For those who may not understand what is hybrid, remember, there are domains and domains of the spectrum of war which are employed as and when this is required. And that is how it is fought. We had issues through the 90s. I thought in the 90s, the government of India and its opposition in India played it out marvelously. There was a excellent political consensus which does not exist today. What I must give full marks to Pakistan for that at that time was the manner in which the information strategy was played out. The ISPR much more than the ISI. In India, everyone knows what the ISI is. No one knows what the ISPR is. It's only people like me who speak about the ISPR. ISPR did an outstanding work for Pakistan, ensuring detailed alienation of the Kashmiri public against the Indian armed forces first and then against the Indian nation. The aspect of hybrid has just not been understood in India. The issue that hybrid can only be countered by hybrid. Hybrid cannot be countered by conventional. The Americans learned it the hard way. They tried to counter hybrid in Iraq and hybrid in Afghanistan by going in conventional. They learned it. It took them 18 years to learn it. $5 trillion down the wherever. Indian response. Let me speak of one or two things on the Indian response. Kargil had its effect. The LOC fence had its effect in 2003, and it started changing a lot of as far as the nature of conflict was concerned. We had a very positive period in India-Pakistan relations 2004 to 2008, when we had the backroom diplomacy, looking at fuzzy borders, borders becoming irrelevant. That somehow did not last, and I spoke to a lot of people, prominent people in Pakistan, who told me that even if this had ever emerged as a solution, perhaps inside Pakistan, the leadership, the military leadership, would probably never have accepted it. It was only General Musharraf who was for it. And the nature of conflict changed in 2008, and you found this was happening with the construction of the LOC fence, the reduction in the strength of terrorists inside, and you found the coming of the Intifada, the first Intifada, the so-called Intifada, the stone throwing, and taking their thing down to the streets, to the people, and that created much more alienation. 2010 onwards, in 2010 I was the co-commander. 2008-9-10 we had a particularly bad period of 3 years of stone throwing agitations. 2010 when I took over, we worked out on a thing called the Hart's Doctrine. It worked marvelously. It put back the proxy war to a very large extent, but somehow we could not entirely sustain it. This was the period when the new generation after 20 years of conflict was emerging. This is the generation which was born in 87, 88, 89. At the inception of the whole conflict. And social media came to their rescue, not ours, and social media actually helped in manipulation of this entire thing. specific issues today, which I've been asked to address. The issue becomes worse because of radicalization. And radicalization is something which has been used in a very appropriate way to bring about greater alienation. The 800 to 1,000 odd mosques inside the valley, which were essentially Sufi in nature, have all become radicalized. Today, the leadership in the mosques, the clergy in the mosques is of a changed nature. They are no longer Kashmiri, they come from different parts of India, who are otherwise also cultivated. The propensity of local youth for militancy is high, because at funerals particularly, there's a tremendous amount of passion at funerals. There have been funerals of Pakistani terrorists also inside Kashmir. Those do not draw that kind of attraction, but much higher is the attraction towards the funerals of local terrorists, and that is what creates a tremendous amount of alienation. The ISIS is a misnomer in Kashmir. Please don't even look at it. There is no such thing as ISIS in Kashmir. It's only a red herring, essentially to try and divert attention from the rest of the issues. How far does Azadi resonate today? There are too many fence sitters in Kashmir. And yes, Azadi is very much resonates. Unfortunately, India's democracy gives tremendous freedom to people. Politicians, media, I hope you're aware, there are 30 newspapers, English newspapers published in Srinagar every morning. That many are not published in London. That means the number which are published in Srinagar, all free to publish what they want. And this democracy is what actually promotes a tremendous amount of alienation. It allows people to do exactly what they wish to. And India, instead of restricting any democracy, has always promoted it. Is democracy good? Well, in 7 years' time, from 1989 to 1996, in 7 years' time, we had elections in Kashmir and we had 2% and 5% turnout, but yet we went in for democracy. We reached 65% turnout in the year 2014. Unfortunately, later the issues have come to such a stage where we have not been able to conduct the election in Anantnag. Is there Operation All Out, which was conducted for the last 2 years, muscular approach, how effective has it been? Well, in the year 2018, we have killed 253 terrorists altogether, all types, local and foreign terrorists. Foreign terrorists in this case are only Pakistanis. I can tell you this, that besides killing 253, 190 locals got recruited and over 70 infiltrated. So we were back to square one. So basically the muscular approach cannot always work. Muscular approach has to be accompanied, I always say, by much of soft power. Regarding policy against the Hurriyat, against financial conduits, radicalization, better governance, this is where the understanding of hybrid has to come. This is where everyone has to understand that countering hybrid can only be countered by hybrid. For example, the financial conduits have just not been targeted by India for all these years. That's why I always say that the Indian democracy sometimes comes back to shoot itself in the foot. Don't ever pull out the army. I always tell everyone, don't pull out the army with premature victory. We pulled out the army from South Kashmir in 2011 and 12, declaring premature victory because of absence of violence. Just remember, in hybrid conflict anywhere in the world, absence of violence is never normalcy. Normalcy is only when networks have been completely taken down. Was Pulwama expected? The issue of Pulwama, was it expected? Absolutely, I expected it. I knew that a big IED or a big suicide attack has to take place in Kashmir. The last one which had taken place in Kashmir was 2004, and before that in 2001. And I knew that since then what has happened in Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, and within Pakistan's internal security problems, how the suicide bomber has come, how the use of the explosives have been made, it was obvious that this is going to make a re-entry. And it did. Whether it would happen at this particular time, I could not have said it, but it did. And it was important that the space which was eroding, the military space which was eroding because of the effectiveness of Operation All Out, 253 terrorists killed in a year was a fairly large number, not as high as 2001, when we killed 2,100 terrorists. It was 10 times lower. But yet the military space was dwindling for the terrorists. In our case, the domination was increasing, and it was important that that space is regained by something spectacular. Pulwama was a spectacular act. Is the ID culture likely to stay on in Kashmir? I do think so. I do think so, but it will not be an everyday affair like it used to happen in the late 90s. Is there a likelihood of war between India and Pakistan? I say no. Just remember, Mr. Modi made every effort in 2015, leading to his visit to Lahore and on Christmas Day. You can't blame him. At the end of it, within 7 days of that, you had Pulwama, you had Pathankot. And ever since then, we have always been only looking back, not looking forward. My only concluding thing which I will say is, I don't think we are looking at any solutions in this conflict. We are only looking for internal stabilization at this particular moment. I do think many people who lead this affair in Pakistan are congratulating themselves and appearing very gung-ho that they will not let go a perceived opportunity which may come their way. I think people are going to be mistaken. India has the Indian propensity to take hold of Kashmir and ensure that nothing worse happens than what has already happened is very high. I have all the confidence in my army. I have all the confidence in my government. Willing to take any questions at any time. Thank you so much.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Mr. Chairman, friends and colleagues, Assalamu alaikum and very good afternoon to all of you. Jammu Kashmir is blessed with natural beauty and natural resources. Also, we are lucky to have two very good neighbors. They tell us not to think about your future because they are doing that for us. They know what is good for us. Also, they tell us not to worry about your identity and culture because they are happy to give us their identity and culture. Aren't we lucky? Mr. Chairman, the terrorist attack in Christchurch once again reinforced our contention that terrorism should not be associated with any religion or community. Terrorists use different covers and slogans to justify their actions. In this context, they use religion to camouflage their agenda. I am a practicing Muslim. Should I be killed because of that? Conversely, just because I am a practicing Muslim, should I kill others? Answer to both questions is in negative. Terrorists are enemies of people and civil liberties. As a Muslim, as a human rights activist, as a British citizen, and as a Democrat, I strongly condemn terrorism in its all forms and manifestations. Mr. Chairman, relationship between terrorism and democracy. What is the relationship between terrorism and democracy, if any? Can democracy and terrorism coexist? Can democracy eliminate terrorism? These are some of the questions which worry governments and thinkers. Some analysts think we may not be able to completely defeat terrorism and eradicate its infrastructure and its sources because of complexities and nature of hybrid war and terrorism. A true democratic system empowers people and ensures there is peace and stability. Prime responsibility of every democratic government is to protect life, liberty, and property of the people. Terrorists, on the other hand, challenge the democratic values and try to impose their will on people. They try to keep people in constant fear. They intentionally kill, destroy, and frighten people because they think that is helping to project their agenda. Whereas democracies want to promote fundamental rights of all citizens and establish law and order, terrorists, on the other hand, want to trample these rights. Terrorism and democracy are incompatible, with conflicting interests and opposing views. Democracies are under attack from terrorists, but democracies are best equipped to fight back and defeat terrorists and those who sponsor extremism and terrorism. In its fights against terrorist groups, a legitimate and popular government can draw support from the public by granting them fundamental rights and accepting their identities. Mr. Chairman, it's disappointing to note that extremism and violence is on rise in South Asia, and Jammu Kashmir is not an exception to that. Some people claim that proxy war and terrorism in Kashmir started in 1988-89. I respectfully disagree with that. The proxy war and terrorism in Kashmir started in October 1947. The ruler of Jammu and Kashmir had a standstill agreement with Pakistan. On 22nd of October 1947, Pakistan violated that written agreement and launched a tribal attack with intention to occupy Jammu and Kashmir. This act of Pakistan was against teaching of Islam. Quran says, Surah Al-Ma'idah, ayat number 1, O people of faith, honor your pledges. This Islamic ruling also is applicable to Pakistan. Pakistan committed an act of aggression against a small neighbor in which tens of thousands of innocent people were killed, women raped and kidnapped. Some people propagate that a legal position of both India and Pakistan is same. I disagree with that too. Pakistan entered Jammu and Kashmir on 22nd of October 1947 by violating a written agreement against the will of the ruler of Jammu and Kashmir with intention to occupy Jammu and Kashmir. Attackers were permitted to loot, plunder and kidnap women. India, on the other hand, came to Jammu and Kashmir on the request of the ruler of Jammu and Kashmir after signing an agreement with the intention of protecting life and liberty and property of the people and driving out the invaders. Looting, rapes, and kidnapping were not permitted to went there to push out the invaders. Pakistan was seen as an aggressor in Jammu and Kashmir by the international community. That is why Security Council resolution of 13th of August 1948 demanded that Pakistan should withdraw all their troops from Jammu and Kashmir, withdraw all the tribesmen who went there, and also withdraw all the Pakistanis who went there for the purpose of fighting. After the Pakistani withdrawal, India was asked to withdraw only bulk of the forces. We people of Jammu and Kashmir believe that the unprovoked Pakistani attack created a situation which resulted in the first India-Pakistan war and forced division of our motherland, Jammu and Kashmir. India came to Kashmir to drive out invaders and protect life, liberty, and of people. India failed to do that. Instead, India is also responsible for human rights abuses in Kashmir, and their excuse is that they are fighting terrorists. Mr. Chairman, it is not my responsibility to fight these militants because I am not trained for that. It is the responsibility of Indian government to protect all citizens of Jammu and Kashmir. We continue to suffer on both sides of the divide since 1947. On line of control, whether Shell is fired by India or fired by Pakistan, we people of Jammu and Kashmir suffer on both sides of the divide, and we get killed. Those who want to combat and eradicate extremism and terrorism must also think of preventive measures. For example, if extremists attack, intimidate, terrorize, and even kill minorities, including Muslims, with impunity in India, then it is not prudent to expect that extremism and terrorism can be successfully combated and eradicated in a disputed and volatile state like Jammu and Kashmir. Apart from that, what is India's policy with regard to Gilgit and Baltistan? What is their policy with regard to Pakistani administered Kashmir? And another thing, is banning political parties is a way forward? I mean, JKLF, I'm not a part of JKLF anymore, but JKLF has been practicing, they are promoting peace and democratic values. And they have been banned, and their chief is in prison at present, and he needs urgent medical help. And I expect that the government of India will do that. Mr. Chairman, as the situation stands, no party to the dispute can impose a solution by force. So first step should be to stop hostilities and save lives. We have seen enough suffering and dead bodies. Both India and Pakistan should pull back and create 5 miles of no man's land along the LOC, where people of Jammu and Kashmir can meet, socialize, discuss political, social, and economic issues. Mr. Chairman, some issues of concern. I like to see peace in Afghanistan too. However, we need to learn from the history. After the Soviet withdrawal, some of the jihadis became unemployed and they were directed to Kashmir. And we are still suffering because of that policy. In view of that, what needs to be discussed is after the complete withdrawal of American troops from Afghanistan, what will happen? I know there is going to be intense infighting between various groups who are competing for space. But one thing is for sure, some of these jihadi warriors could be directed to Kashmir. And I'm really concerned about that. After, another issue here is that Kashmir war theater is insufficient to accommodate all the mujahids. They may have godfathers of jihad, who thinks that jihad has to continue throughout life. They may have to find other areas where these jihadis could be sent. Although I support peace and dialogue, however, if India resumes dialogue with Pakistan now, especially after Pulwama, won't that be construed as a win for Pakistani strategy of bleeding India with many cuts and terrorizing India and the region with nuclear weapons? Won't that be seen as a success of the Pakistani tactics of using proxy warriors to promote their agenda? Won't that be perceived as a success of Pakistani policy of using religion to camouflage their strategy of promoting extremism, religious hatred, intolerance, and terrorism? Above all, won't this be taken as a success of their nuclear blackmail to bring India to the negotiating table, despite a long trail of terrorist acts? And lastly, Mr. Chairman, after this success, my worry is, what will be their next target? What will be the message for other aspiring regimes which don't believe in pluralism and democratic ideals? I thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Always a pleasure to come back to IISS. I think I was here exactly a year ago, Rahul, but speaking on India's national security policies that time. But we are now speaking on a much more focused subject of Jammu and Kashmir and the way forward. And I would like to take forward what General Hasnain said about what the status of insurgency is in Jammu and Kashmir. And I agree with him that it's not insurgency anymore, or has not been an insurgency for a long time. In fact, it's war by another name. And if you look back only just 6 years, from 2013 onwards, there was a very subtle change of strategy by Pakistani-based terrorist groups and Pakistani sponsors of terrorist groups, where they started attacking military installations and military convoys, military military cantonments for deliberately provoking India into precipitated action, starting with a convoy attack on a military convoy in Srinagar in 2013. It went on to Uri, the Mohra gun position in Uri, Nagrota, Pathankot, then you finally have Pulwama. So it's been a change of strategy. Rather than attacking civilian population or civilian targets or indiscriminate fighting, they started attacking military installations to try and provoke India into a more military response rather than the old CICT response. So that's where this change has come. And that is where I think India has now decided that if there is a terrorist attack based by people based in or terrorists based and sponsored by Pakistan, then India will not hesitate to use conventional military methods to try and give a befitting response or a robust response. And that's what we saw in the surgical strikes in September 2016. That's what we saw in Balakot, that if you attack our installations or our troops or our people in Jammu and Kashmir through terrorist proxies, then we will not hesitate to use military means. This has been the Indian response since 2014. And that's where concurrently the crackdown has happened on the terrorist proxies or the overground workers, overground supporters of terrorism and Pakistan based in Jammu and Kashmir. And that is where the Huriyat has been targeted. The target has been the terrorist funding, the Hawala route of money coming into Jammu and Kashmir, banning the Jamaat-e-Islami, banning the JKLF, and also strengthening the security grid across the line of control and making sure that the funding is choked as far as the terrorist groups are concerned. Now, that's where the challenge to the subcontinent comes in. That what if next attack comes from Pakistan or from Pakistani-based terrorist groups? what will be India's response? Will it go further than what it has been in the last two instances of where we saw what happened in the surgical strikes and in Balakot? Who knows? And that's where I think the strategy, India has changed its strategy as far as dealing with terrorism is concerned. Also about JNK, I need to sort of state this up front, that this common notion that the entire state of Jammu and Kashmir and the people of Jammu and Kashmir support terrorism or secessionism is not just a misnomer, it's a fallacy. Because the large or majority population is interested in their day-to-day activities, survival, and their own livelihood, rather than waiting or supporting terrorist activities, which is mostly anyway driven by Pakistani policy. So the larger population is more interested in leading a normal life, and that's what we need to recognize, which the Indian government is now slowly trying to work on those people rather than give importance to a minuscule population or a minuscule elite, which benefits from perpetuating the discourse on Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir, as this is a disputed territory between India and Pakistan. It needs resolution, it needs international mediation. In fact, the two mainstream political parties in Jammu and Kashmir have willy-nilly or otherwise have perpetuated this myth and have benefited from this stand by saying that it's a dispute, India needs to sit down with Pakistan, India needs to discuss this across the table, and they have in the bargain actually played in the hands of the separatists. That is where I think the change in strategy has come, that the Indian government, the current Indian government has decided that it will not try and indulge the separatists, the Hurriyat and their proxies. In fact, they will crack down hard on them and see to it that the overground support provided by this minuscule population is limited, so that the rest of the population, which is not really interested in perpetuating the insurgency or the war by another name, therefore they need to be supported in a larger way is the government's policy. And I think the mainstream, my complaint to the mainstream political parties in Jammu and Kashmir has been that they've played in the hands of the Hurriyat and the separatists. I think they should have recognized this trap that they got into and have not been able to come out of that. In fact, that is one of the reasons why I think the assembly elections have been sort of put off to be held after the Lok Sabha elections. And yet, grassroots democracy in Jammu and Kashmir has been well established. If you look at the number of elections that have been held since 1947 or 1948, there have been 11 state assembly elections, 12 Lok Sabha elections, 5 municipal elections, 3 panchayat elections as late as 2018. And all of them have seen varying degree of participation, but people have participated wherever they're possible. In fact, as I think Nirul Hasnain mentioned, it went up to 80% in some of the parts of Jammu and Ladakh. And now that is the other third point I want to make, that when we speak about Kashmir in the international fora or in the international debate or discourse, it's not about Kashmir Valley alone or the 5 districts of Kashmir. Jammu and Kashmir is a much larger state. It includes Ladakh, it includes Jammu. And in fact, the area occupied by Pakistan, which is popularly called as Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, should, in my view, be called Pakistan-occupied Jammu and Kashmir. Because on the day Jammu and Kashmir acceded to India, that was a territory which was under the princely state, which was part of, which acceded to India. And therefore, the last point I want to make here, that the accession of Jammu and Kashmir is full and final. There is no dispute about India's control and sovereignty over Jammu and Kashmir. That includes the Pakistan-occupied Jammu and Kashmir, because the constitution of Jammu and Kashmir, which was adopted by the Constituent Assembly of Jammu and Kashmir on 17th November 1956, it reads like this, and I quote, "We the people," the preamble of the constitution of JNK reads, and I quote, "We the people of the state of Jammu and Kashmir, having solemnly resolved in pursuance of the accession of this state to India, which took place on 26th October 1947, to further define the existing relationship of the state with the Union of India as an integral part thereof," unquote. Section 3 of the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir reads, "The state of Jammu and Kashmir is and shall be an integral part of the Union of India." Section 4 of the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir reads, "The territory of the state shall comprise all the territories which on the 15th of August 1947 were under the sovereignty of the ruler of the state." And finally, Section 5 of the Constitution of J&K reads, and I quote, "The executive and legislative power of the state extends to all matters except those with respect to which Parliament has power to make laws for the state under the provisions of the Constitution of India." So the only dispute in my view that needs, or only matter that needs resolution, is vacation of the parts of Jammu and Kashmir occupied by Pakistan and nothing else. India's full control of Jammu and Kashmir is full and final. There are documents, there are views of people like Sheikh Abdullah, which are on record, which need to be taken into consideration. So this whole thing about Kashmir dispute between India and Pakistan is itself a fallacy. And I think the earlier Pakistan realizes this, the better it is, because otherwise this war and this conflict will go on, because India is not going to give up the control over what is Jammu and Kashmir and what will be Jammu and Kashmir whenever the rest of the parts of Jammu and Kashmir are controlled by India. Thank you very much for your time. Thank
you. And I want to sort of take forward some of the perspectives you all have put across, but bring in at the same time the current post-Pulwama environment in Jammu and Kashmir. And the question is this, that we have seen, as some of the speakers have talked about, a muscular policy that the Indian government has put across since 2014. We've also seen, as another panelist put it, an attempt in the past of having a hearts and mind strategy in Kashmir. We've, in the last few weeks, again, the elements of the former in terms of the banning of the Jammu and Kashmir Liberation Front as well as Jamaat-e-Islami, which one of the panelists sort of questioned and criticized. The question, therefore, to the panel is this. What do you think will happen now? What do you think the Indian government's policy will be towards Kashmir post-Pulwama? Will it be toughening up of the muscular policy, or will it be an attempt at seeking engagement within Kashmir to political players within Kashmir in trying to ease some of the tensions that we've seen recently? Why don't you, and then we can go in the same order. It's all.
Right. Can you hear me with this? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Raul, for that. I'll be brief. Firstly, I think it's a misnomer. The muscular policy, so to say, no Indian government has ever called its policy muscular. It's a title given by the media, which loves to give these kind of titles. The policy which has been followed by the government of India and the Indian Army and the security forces has always been the same, right from the beginning. The only thing is, from 1989 till 2019, there has been a meandering up and down, where it's a very dynamic conflict, where hard and soft power has been mixed in different ratios. And you suddenly saw in 2016, when the Burhan Wani incident took place, you suddenly found an upsurge of perhaps a higher degree of hard power rather than soft power. And that is what led the media to call it the muscular policy. I don't think it's going to change too much. The policy will continue. There's a necessity to go after the terrorists. It's not necessary to hit only the terrorists. The more important thing is to hit the terrorist leaders, the leadership. Hit the leadership, hit the financial conduits, go hybrid, go after ideology, go after recruitment, possible recruitment. All this is going to form a part of the Indian policy. And it has been there, and in different ways it will get tweaked and nothing more. As far as the bans are concerned, I personally would say this is something which has been demanded for years. The Jamaat, most people do not know, the Jamaat is not located in Srinagar. Jamaat is located in Kulgam. And South Kashmir, the restiveness in South Kashmir is primarily because of the Jamaat there. And this demand has been there, although the Jamaat cadres today are saying that we are the people who have been legally functioning and we have been doing nothing. But the Jamaat has been hugely responsible for what is happening in South Kashmir. There's no doubt about it. And as far as the other aspects of policy are concerned, I think the Indian government will look, the security forces will take a leaf out of the out of Pakistan's strategy, and that is to use information, information operations, counter-radicalization, de-radicalization, which has not really been successful anywhere in the world. I think that is the route which it will follow. But the next 3-4 months are a period in which of uncertainty, in which you are not going to find any major policy formulations. This is election time. By the time elections end in Kashmir, in Jammu and Kashmir, you will find the next assembly elections coming up in June, July or August. So for 6 months, there's a bit of an hiatus. You will find things happening after that. Thank you.
Right. Well, let's not call it muscular, let's call it a harsh policy. In my opinion, this harsh policy will continue, especially after Pulwama. I think what the Indian government has to see is that with this harsh policy, there are human rights violations which have been abused. Paratroops and security forces, if you can call them security forces, they are committing some human rights abuses. And some innocent people do suffer. I have no issue if you are after militants and if you kill them, or vice versa. That's like fighting two. I mean, I'm not in favor of violence, but I mean, that can be seen differently. But killing of innocent people cannot be justified under any pretext. And there's been a lot of innocent suffering we have seen in Kashmir. And I mean, this is not to say that we don't have any problems on the Pakistani side of the Kashmir, even though we don't use guns. We don't, we're not even at times allowed to protest peacefully. But then it doesn't mean that India should go ahead with this harsh policy. But my concern is that especially during the election time and after the Pulwama, New Delhi will act very harshly and there will be a lot of suffering in Jammu and Kashmir.
Thank you, Nithin.
Yes. It's on. Okay. Can you hear me? Yeah, I would tend to see this as a mix of hard and soft power really to be used in Jammu and Kashmir, where there will be necessary crackdown.
Oh, sorry, you think you're going to press there?
I can't see where to press.
Just press on the...
This one?
Yeah. There is a tape here. Is this?
Can I? Yeah. Okay. Sorry. So as I was saying, it will be a mix of hard and soft power to be used in Jammu and Kashmir. Already we have seen the hard approach where for too long the indulgence given to the separatists and their supporters was taken for granted by them, and therefore they were working with impunity and with a lot of freedom. That has now been curtailed. As I mentioned, the NIA cases, the National Investigative Agency cases against the Hurriyat leaders, their proxies, their hawala transactions, their terror financing has been now looked at very seriously and with proper evidence, although it needs to be taken to its logical conclusion in the courts, but at least the process has begun. Similarly, on the soft side, a lot of development initiatives have been taken, and many people do not know outside India or even within India that most students today from Jammu and Kashmir, those who can afford and who do get support from the governments, both the state and the center, are going out in larger numbers to rest of India. I have found, I am from Maharashtra, although I haven't lived there for the last 35 years. I find people studying in remote parts like Sangli, Kolhapur, Belgaum, on the border of Karnataka, studying there, and maybe 10 or 15% of them staying back to do jobs and take up some business. So the so-called integration of the Kashmiris and the Jammu and Kashmir people with rest of India is actually an ongoing process, like what happened with the Northeast. That is something that is missed, and the government is doing a lot of effort on that. De-radicalization, I think, needs a little more attention. But I think it's going to be a mix of the two approaches. But the hard approach was a long time coming. I'm glad it has come now, because without that, you cannot have a rule of law which is applicable elsewhere in the country, was not applicable to certain people in Jammu and Kashmir. Now that has changed, and that is a welcome change, I think.
Thank you. Let me now turn to the floor. I've got some names. If you want to be on the list, please put your hand up, and I'll be able to put your name on the list. Yes, I've got a show of hands. Let me turn first to my colleague, Antoine.
Thank you, Rahul. Gentlemen, thank you very much for very insightful presentations. My question, I have two, in fact, are to General Attar Hasnain. So you referred to the past formula of making the border irrelevant between the two countries in this part of the region. What exactly is the status of the hopes which one could have about that? And my second question is, do you think there's any likelihood that a spectacular attack could take place inside Kashmir involving mass civilian casualties? Thank you.
It's for you.
All right, thank you, and very good questions. The first one, the aspect of irrelevant borders, I'll be very brief so that they have enough time for others to ask questions. It all started in 2004. It was Pervez Musharraf's idea, no doubt about it. A four-point formula which he had brought out. It had a ready acceptance in India, the Indian leadership. And for 4 years, we had what is called backroom diplomacy. Mr. Sati Lamba, who was an Indian ambassador, played this out entirely with his counterpart in Pakistan. And things did improve a lot. But we were not ever certain as to where would this ultimately go. It was a good thing to stabilize India-Pakistan relations, but the end, there was nothing, there was no light at the end of the tunnel. And in 2007, the Lal Masjid incident in Pakistan, and subsequently 26/11, the Mumbai attack, put an end to the entire thing. So we haven't revisited it ever since then. As far as its acceptance today and overall any positive outlook towards it, I think it's zero. No one is even looking at it. What you just got to remember as a student of this entire thing is, in 1994, 22nd of February, a resolution has been passed by the Parliament of India, joint resolution of the two houses of Parliament, all parties coming together, which declares that the entire territory of Jammu and Kashmir, which was under the control of the Maharaja of Kashmir, belongs to India, and India will aspire to get it back. Now, if you have to go against this, then you have to go back to Parliament. Just remember, we are a democracy, the same manner in which the UK is. And so everything has to ultimately go back to Parliament. The second question, the spectacular act. This spectacular act, Pulwama, was about servicemen, killing of 40 servicemen. And you are referring to the possibility of large-scale, mass-scale killings of civilians. It's happened in the past. It's happened many times in the past. The Lashkar-e-Toyba had a system wherein whenever they wanted to declare that they had now established their footprint in a particular area of Kashmir, they would do a spectacular act of killing Kashmiri pundits. We had Vandama, if you remember, we had Vandama, we had Nandimar, we had all kinds of incidents like that, right? Can that come back today? There are not enough Kashmiri pundits around today. There are minority pockets in Kashmir. We are defending them very strongly. But I think a suicide bomber coming in to attack Kashmiris themselves may not be there. Minorities is possible, but there aren't enough minorities left in Kashmir to target. It is possible only to target primarily military facilities. The last sentence on this, just remember an incident in Pakistan, and Pakistan has suffered this hugely. A terrorist, a suicide bomber who was caught in Pakistan by the Pakistani security forces, when questioned, "Why are you doing this? Why are you doing this to your fellow Muslims?" And his answer on Jio TV, I remember seeing it, was, "These are not Muslims. These Pakistanis are not Muslims. Muslims are only people like me who believe something different." So with that kind of a belief, killing Kashmiri Muslims in an act is very much possible. It's very much possible. The re-entry of the IED and the suicide bomber is something which we have to be very careful about.
Shamisa, you want to add quickly to that?
I'm not sure
if I can add quickly, but I do want to answer.
Yeah.
Well, on one end, people's
say that Kashmir is integral part of India. As far as I understand, that accession has to be ratified by the people. And to the best of my knowledge, that ratification has not taken place. And then on the other hand, you say you're making borders irrelevant. Does that mean still Kashmir is, the entire state of Jammu Kashmir is your integral part, but the two regions, so-called Azad Kashmir and Hindustan, which remain under the administration of Pakistan, how is that going to work? As far as the other issue is concerned, in my opinion, I hope I'm wrong.
You just pressed, yeah.
I did?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I hope I'm wrong, but I think there's going to be another incident in which lots of casualties.
It's going to be a horrible incident.
Another one.
Yeah, there will be another one. Pulwama is gone. You know, we've seen what happened after that. My feeling is that there is going to be another incident, and perhaps more serious than what we have seen in Pulwama. In Pulwama, yes, I agreed, it were the men in uniform who were targeted. This time, target could be different. But these people who think that jihad has to go on for life, and by doing that, they will get heaven, whatever, you know, they're not going to give it up. There will be another incident of terrorism, and God knows what will happen after that, because the Indian government, I feel, is going to react to that and react very harshly, and there could be serious problems.
Thank you. Let me turn to this side, Victoria Schofield, and then I want to take a question from that gentleman there. Victoria, do you want to identify yourself for
microphone, yes. Thank you very much. There was a lot in all the presentations to absorb. There's a couple of things. Firstly, on the issue of Gilgit-Baltistan, I think my question is really to Mr. Gokhale. India is the world's largest democracy. So what situation could you envisage when you say that the only matter that needs resolution is vacation of the territory occupied by Pakistan? Supposing the inhabitants of Gilgit-Baltistan don't actually want to become part of India after 70 years and they're happier with their status, could this not be a subject for discussion with Pakistan? Because surely you're going to apply the same principles of democracy to the regions rather than really regarding it as a piece of real estate. And my second question is to General Hassanan. I covered the insurgency during the 1990s, and I'm seeing a repeat of all the rhetoric and of all the dialogue, the harsh approach, then the soft approach that took place in the 1990s. The catchword then, the phrase, was winning back hearts and minds. What a mistake would you say the Indian government has made during that period, not to have won back hearts and minds when they were determined to do so in the 1990s, most particularly the current use of pellet guns, which has clearly alienated a generation of Kashmiris, and these are indigenous Kashmiris that are being hit. They're not people who are being hit that have come across from Pakistan. So I just wondered if you could say a little bit more on that. Thank you.
Let me just, yes, the gentleman there, if you identify yourself.
I am Major Arun Chauhan from 11 Marathas. Thank you, sir. I am studying IR at LSE. My question is, since you said it is a hybrid war and cognitive spectrum is the most important spectrum where it has to be fought. So from the IR's perspective, if we really want to fight, then we have to take it in the region, not only, it cannot only remain focused in Kashmir. We have to see the de-radicalization of the entire region. If CIA in 1970s can fund Mujahideens, then we can also fund Sufism to counter radicalization. So, Indian.
Thank you. If you answer this, yeah, sure. We can do next round.
Yeah, sure. So, should I?
Yeah. And then if just press it. Yeah, now speak.
Now?
Yeah,
it's working. Yeah, okay. I agree with you as far as the choices for the Gilgit-Baltistan people is concerned. But first, Pakistan, the resolution, the UN resolution, steps have to be followed. If Pakistan follows those steps, let us see if Pakistan can allow the people, their elected representative of POJK, to decide whether they want to join back in India or they remain in Pakistan. That can be the next second step. The first, let Pakistan vacate the area which was decided under the UN resolution. I think
is that realistic?
No, so is this realistic? Is the Gilgit-Baltistan people not wanting to come? We don't know. Because that's, I'm just saying that that's the resolution of the Indian Parliament, so we'll have to stick by it. I mean, that is the only point of dispute, as I see it, between India and Pakistan. Rest of it, for Pakistan to say we have a stake in Jammu and Kashmir, as they call the Indian-controlled Jammu and Kashmir, is, I think, a misnomer. What is the stake that Pakistan has in the Indian Jammu and Kashmir, if they say Indian Jammu and Kashmir? That is the point that I'm trying to make.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. That was an excellent question. The one on winning hearts and minds. Anyone who understands hybrid war, understands counterinsurgency, counterterrorism, knows that any military will always follow, carry out what is called military civic action, MCA. MCA is not soft power. MCA is not psychological operations. And that's why in 30 years, India has made many mistakes as far as its strategy is concerned. One of the major mistakes has been to think that military civic action is psychological operations. It is information operations. It is not. If anyone has taught us how to play information operations, it is the ISPR of Pakistan, who's done it marvelously. I like to give it back to them always, the credit to them, right? And for many years we thought that the introduction of military civic action officially called Operation Sadbhavna, it is called Sadbhavna. Operation Sadbhavna is all about winning hearts and minds of the people. It is not that. It is only supplementing the administrative efforts of the government in areas where the outreach of the government is not there in a situation of terror. That is the issue. We, in 2010, as the Corps commander, I was one who realized it. We went whole hog on carrying this out to a next level. The Hart's doctrine that we played out was something at a higher level, learned from what the Americans were doing in Iraq to a very great extent also. But somehow we could not sustain it. And this hybrid conflict has all been about ups and downs. One day India on top, dominant, and the other day Pakistan as the controller of the proxy war, dominant. I think from 2012 onwards, Pakistan got an upper hand. And the change of the generation and the coming of social media made all the difference. We didn't know how to carry out the information side of it. Pakistan had done it adroitly. They did it extremely well. And that is what led to this kind of alienation which we are existing in today.
And the pellet guns?
Sorry?
Pellet guns.
Use of pellet guns in the civilian population. It's an international issue.
Yeah. Unfortunate. There are not too many solutions around the world, let me tell you, to mob control. The Israelis have done it marvelously in certain areas, but they've also been very, very hard, extremely hard, in the Intifada against the Palestinians. The Indian security forces could have adopted many more softer practices, but frankly saying, ask me, someone who's been in Kashmir extensively in front of mobs, it's an unnerving thing to be in front of mobs. And to be virtually engulfed by mobs. Conceptually, the pellet gun is not a weapon to use in mob control. Accept it completely. I think today we've taken a back step on that. Many more new things have come in. You have rarely found the use of the pellet gun. You rarely found blindings and things like that taking place in the last few months. But the pellet gun still very much remains in the armory of the police forces.
Okay, very briefly, and then we have lots of questions.
Yeah, on pellet guns, and there is no justification in my opinion. The authorities or security forces need to learn how to control crowds. I mean, it happens the crowds go sometimes violent in London, sometimes in Paris. They don't use pellet guns, and I think there is no justification for that. As far as Gilgit-Baltistan is concerned, and my friend, honorable friend, says that Pakistan has to vacate. We all know that Pakistan did not vacate, and now they have to. What they have agreed is that under Shimla agreement, they will bilaterally decide. So I can't see a situation where India and Pakistan will agree to take it back to Security Council. So really speaking, it's catch 22. As far as people of Gilgit-Baltistan are concerned, I interact with them frequently. Their first choice is to become independent, unfortunately. And then second option could be maybe joining Pakistan, and third is for second maybe for independent Kashmir, and third joining Pakistan, that is debatable. As far as India is concerned, I don't think there is any popularity for India in that region.
Thank you. Let me take the next two people on my list, the gentleman there and Aisha. Siddiqa, yes.
Thank you. My name is Abbas Faiz, and I lecture on human rights at Essex University. So, I mean, it's very interesting what you've all said. But if you look at it from another angle, really, what it means is that there is already an agreement between India and Pakistan to maintain the status quo. Because this status quo is technically supporting the rhetoric that is coming out of the mouths of the politicians on both sides of the border, the populism that is coming out, the populism that came out of, for example, Mr. Modi's mouth after the nasty bomb incident, because he was technically using that in order to consolidate his own power. So how far can it go when we know that the Indian military strategy has not worked, has so frequently not worked, and then on the other side, the kind of Islamic, whatever you want to call it, strategy of kind of, you know, liberation through an ideology has not worked, has so frequently not worked. When is it going to be, you know, how are we going to see a movement that is going to actually move the kind of discourse and the narrative away from this, you know, kind of populism that is coming out, which is really catching, you know, the West as well now, but it has been already the prerogative of the, you know, kind of post-colonial states. So how are we going
Thank
to
you.
Really move away from
Got
that?
It. Thank you very much. Aisha Siddiq, yes.
Hi, welcome to London. I have a brief comment and two questions. Mr. Chaudhry, you said about Gilgit-Baltistan that you know that people in Gilgit-Baltistan are pro-independence. I, as a Pakistani, would probably kind of suggest to you that you probably in India focused too much on certain voices. You don't get all the voices. To think that majority of Gilgit-Baltistanis are pro-independence, you probably need to revisit it. Quick question to you, General. De-radicalization, of course, that is the key, it's a long-term plan. My question is, de-radicalization is at two levels. One is political. And the damage that has been done through pellet guns, you know, which Victoria has already talked about, and especially post-Pulwama, the way Kashmiri students were harassed, beaten up at different places. And related to that is the second level of de-radicalization, which is religious. How do you go about it when you will do de-radicalization? Will it just be the Kashmiris, or would it include Hindutva as well? Because there is right wing expanding in India everywhere.
Thank you. Let's take these two. Yes.
I can do it first.
Sure. Yeah, please.
Okay. Thank you. Very complex question. Very, very interesting question on. First of all, sir, I don't know the presumption that there is a virtual status quo. Yes, there's a virtual status quo, nothing official, right? Where the ceasefire line was converted to the line of control in 1972 under the Shimla Agreement remains there. Our Indian contention is very clear that the conflict has moved on from 1947, 48, 49, from the Karachi Agreement, from the UN resolution, is no longer valid. Everything is under 1972, the Shimla Agreement. Pakistan does not agree to that. Despite having signed on the dotted line of 1972, the Shimla Agreement.
Pakistan is due.
Sorry?
Many Pakistan.
Okay. Maybe, but.
Okay.
There will be, if the Pakistan government doesn't. They don't follow a policy.
Okay, you can take.
They do not follow a policy on that. Otherwise, they wouldn't be pursuing it in the month of August every year in the United Nations, because the United Nations plays no role in this. And they wouldn't be asking us they wouldn't be telling me, why don't you agree to the UN Military Observer Group? Because the UN Military Observer Group is invalid in Kashmir, as per the Shimla Agreement. It's only India, the fact that India is just maintaining it there, accepting it there, nothing else. Right? So there is a status quo which has come about, there are the dynamics of the situation. It's not that it's been worked out together to a status quo. Much can change if Pakistan changes its attitude, perhaps, on this. India-Pakistan talks can take place. When did Mr. Modi ever say that we will not speak to Pakistan at all? He always said, talks and terror will not go together. And that is the more important aspect. How can you expect us? 40 men of ours are killed here, 100 men are killed there. The next spectacular act, as Mr. Chaudhary says, is likely to take place anytime in the near future. How do you expect the government of India to start saying, no, no, let's have 100 men dying here, let's have, we'll have mutual cultural relations and play cricket with each other and everything is hunky-dory? It can't happen. 30 years of it has gone on too long. And that is why it's actually a part of Pakistani strategy, to actually exasperate us. Right? All this is an entire theory of a thousand cuts, to exasperate India and get us into a situation where we act desperately. Always try and make sure that they remain under the threshold of tolerance. Somehow put Obama across the tolerance. And the next act is going to cost the tolerance in a huge way. So I'm not looking at anything stable happening in the near future, anytime. Coming specifically to the question...
De-radicalization.
Or de-radicalization. Yes, you're absolutely right, Aisha. There are two levels at which it has to be seen. One is the political part of it. The political part of it creates alienation. The radicalization, actual religious radicalization, creates bonding. It creates bonding, transnational, and very largely with Pakistan, elements in Pakistan. Pakistan is not radical in any way. I mean, the society in Pakistan is not radical in any way, but there are radical elements in Pakistan who want to use radicalization as a weapon in India against this, right? So there has to be a lot more to be done on this. I don't think the world has found an answer to it. There are a few countries, small countries like Singapore, etc., which have found reasonably good answers to it, but we are still struggling with it, and we will probably struggle more along with it. As far as the de-radicalization of Hindutva is concerned, I don't think Hindutva has ever said, we are at war. No one has ever said, ours is the only faith. What is the meaning of a radical? Let's understand it. It's the same explanation which I gave you about the GOTV terrorist, who said, these are not Muslims. The ones I have killed are not Muslims. These are Pakistanis who are alien. They don't belong to my religion. I am a Muslim. The way I take it, that is radicalization. No one in Hindutva has ever said that. No one who follows any philosophy of Hindutva has ever said that.
With regard to talks, I am in favor of talks, but is it India-Pakistan dispute or is it Jammu and Kashmir dispute? Where do we stand? Since 1947, India and Pakistan have talked dozens and dozens of times, and there is no solution. Sadly, both countries are interested in conflict management. They are not interested in conflict resolution. And that is what we need, conflict resolution. And people of Jammu Kashmir, who are the main party, somehow they should be made part of the dialogue process. Coming back to radicalization. Well, okay, there is Muslim radicalization, but isn't there extremism in India as well? I know Lieutenant General Saab said that their radicalization is slightly different to Muslim radicalization, but to me, extremist is extremist. Quickly, on 30 seconds, you know, the Gilgit Baltistan, you pointed out, okay, I respect your view, but has there been any survey or any plebiscite which determines the views of people of Gilgit Baltistan? I have a more closer interaction with those people, and I know that just because they are controlled by Pakistan and they don't have a voice, it doesn't mean that they want to join Pakistan. It is not true.
Nitin?
Yeah.
I'll just pick up this part of the song. Part of what Aisha said about Hindutva de-radicalization that is needed. I think this view needs to be revisited. And people who take this view by just reading some of the reports in either India's English press or international press need to revisit the larger population and see the way people live in India. I think that is something that I urge all of you, because for every extreme view or somebody who sort of targeted the Kashmiris after Pulwama, there were 10 Hindus who protected the Kashmiri boys and took them in their houses. So India is a very diverse, large, and a very accommodative society.
taken they're also booked under the law. There is no official encouragement to that, but yes, they feel encouraged because they feel that the current government is a Hindu nationalist party, as everyone wants to call it. But that does not mean that this is a trend that one needs to worry too much about. It is something that can be watched and can be corrected as we go along. But I don't buy or subscribe to this view that the Hindus are getting radicalized to an extent where they hate the Kashmiris. I think that's a fallacy which we need to correct.
Thank you. The next batch of three questions, or three people who can ask questions, the lady there, yes, and then Nick, and then we come to Khalid. Yes. Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Apurva Saral, and I am a cybersecurity advisor for Deloitte Consulting, so hence my question is on technology. My question is, social and print media has been used to our disadvantage.
Who are you addressing it to?
Anyone.
I'm fine whoever answers it. So I'll repeat. So social and print media has been used to our disadvantage to spread terrorism in Kashmir. Did we not see it coming? And how would have we dealt it in a way that we could have used it to our advantage in a democracy like ours?
Thank you. Nicholas, identify yourself. Just.
Thank you, Rahul, and thank you to the panel. Nick Crawford of the IISS. I'm a research associate on the Conflict Security and Development Programme. If I may, I have two hopefully short questions, one on democracy and one on terrorism. So the latter first. General Hassanein, you referred to the groups in Jammu and Kashmir as proxies and that Pakistan is responsible for. Now, obviously under international law, for Pakistan to be responsible for the actions of non-state groups, Pakistan has to have effective operational control over those groups. So I'd like to better understand your assessment of the control that Pakistan has over non-state armed groups in Jammu and Kashmir, and what the source of Pakistan's power is over those groups. So what is the degree of dependence, what is the relationship between them? And the second question, more on democracy, concerns Jamaat-e-Islamiyah. So you referred, General Hassanein, to the group being responsible for the restiveness in southern Kashmir. And again, I'd like to better understand in what ways you believe that Jamaat al-Islamiyah is responsible for that. And perhaps you compared the democracies of India and the UK. Perhaps you could compare Jamaat al-Islamiyah with secessionist efforts in the UK, perhaps in Scotland, and how that differs and is of greater concern. Thank you.
Thank you, yes.
Khalid, South Asia Middle East Forum. Firstly, I'd like to know how civil society in Jammu and Kashmir can flourish under a highly militarized state. Perhaps the general will detail how many Indian troops there are presently in Jammu and Kashmir. And also I'm concerned about, we were talking about terrorism, what are the level of exchanges taking place between the police, defense, and army at the moment? Has it reduced in the current conflict between India and Pakistan? Because this is something which needs to be maintained even at the worst hours of conflict between both of you.
Thank you. We have specific questions, I think, for General Hassanein, and then a general question for others. So why don't you start, and then we can...
Try and be as brief, and I'll start from the reverse order. Easily remembered. Can you hear me clearly?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. The last question. Very interesting question. Civil society. Firstly, where did you get this figure of 500,000 troops? I don't know. Pakistan says 7 lakh. Sometimes they say 8 lakhs. And I don't know the last count. I would be very happy as the co-commander commanding 7 lakh troops. I would say, my God, fantastic. I wish the army had given me 7 lakh troops to command. Never did. I had 4 divisions to command. I had the RR, the Rashtra Rifles, to command 43 battalions of that and my own infantry units and the rest of them. So this is a misnomer. This is part of information warfare, which cultivated into the minds internationally that there are 700,000 troops in Kashmir. They aren't. And India has never been able to counter it, unfortunately. The second thing, does it convert into daily acts of violence, etc.? What is the degree of violence which is taking place? Let me explain it to you this way. In 1998-99, I was the Colonel of Operations of the Victor Force at Avantipur in South Kashmir. At one time, I was controlling 11 operations, contacts with terrorists taking place in South Kashmir. 11 of them at one time I was controlling. I was jumping from handset to telephone set.
Today, if there's one operation in 5 days, consider yourself lucky. Yeah, you've got something to do. Nothing. There are 350 residual terrorists today in Kashmir. But I call these 350 residual terrorists the last mile. And the last mile in counter-terror operations takes the longest time. And you will make the maximum mistakes. In your attempt to kill 350, you will make mistake after mistake. And that is what will continue building up this. Therefore, this is the time for soft power. And soft power is the only manner in which you can deliver. Muscular policy, 20%. Soft power, 80%. So I think I've answered both your issues, questions here. Let me see the other one. On Jammu and Kashmir, the aspect of proxy war, conduct of what is the degree of control that Pakistan has got on it, and what evidence do we have? Evidence is, this is not something, a question of evidence. We are not going into the world. We are not going to the United Nations and telling them all these things. That's Pakistan who's doing it, not us. But we are telling the world, yes, we are suffering from proxy war. And you want this thing to end, you want India and Pakistan to stop this violence in Kashmir, then perhaps we can get together. 6-8 months, complete hiatus from violence, and perhaps we'll be able to talk to each other. The fact is, financial conduits, the manner in which money is coming in, India is still a very soft state, a democratically soft state. We have allowed for the last 30 years money to come from Western Union money transfer. Can you imagine, of all things, Western Union money transfer has actually been transferring terrorist funds into Kashmir. And we've never done very much about it. It is now the last 2-3 years that after Burhanwani incident that the NIA, the National Investigation Agency, has gone into it. It is going to take them a fairly long time to take down all these conduits, take down all the networks. Something which has been established over 30 years can't be undone in a matter of a couple of days or weeks. Degree of control, there's no, I mean, you have to sit some time and see the intercepts that we get, hundreds and thousands of intercepts that we have been getting on the radio communications between terrorist leaders and their controllers inside Pakistan, etc. Anyone who's been on the line of control knows how exactly this whole thing functions. I mean, I could put up a slide for you and tell you the exact structure from Murid K, the recruitment, the money, how it comes together, human resources, explosives, where with weapons and wherewithal, how it all comes together into carry out a terrorist act inside Kashmir. It's not rocket science. It's very, very easy doing that kind of a thing. On the last aspect of social and print media, my colleagues have to also comment on that. This is the major issue in Kashmir, social media. And let me tell you, 2010, I'm a Facebook buff. I'm a Twitter buff, right? And I can tell you one thing. I tried my hardest to play counter proxy war through media. The third day, I ran out of text. I didn't know what to do. What you have to remember in this entire information warfare thing is, it cannot be done by the military. It has to be all of government. It has to be academics. It has to be researchers. It has to be psychologists. All kinds of people have to come into this to do it. At the moment, the world is struggling around with it. No, not finding answers to it. The professional way ultimately is integration of all these resources to fight the social media war. Print media, much more, I think, Cho. Nitin will tell you.
Exchange of intelligence. You didn't mention about police and intelligence between the two countries.
Sorry?
The sort of contact between the police and intelligence of the two countries, India and Pakistan.
Maintaining intelligence contacts.
Yeah.
I hope you're aware that we do have a group under Ottawa University, and the UK, sponsored by UK, a separate group from the UK, where actually intelligence, former intelligence experts of the two countries are meeting each other every 6 months to, you know, discuss various ways of normalization, etc. But this is a completely different track. Track two, the track one doesn't keep somehow converge together. The track two is an idealistic kind of a track, and track one is the more realistic one.
That's it. I mean, you're talking the track two. So non-officials, so retired intelligence officials meet periodically. Shall we? Yeah. And then quickly.
I just want to make one point with regard to these organizations. You mentioned extremist organizations are proxy organizations. You know, okay, there's one issue with regard to their attacks inside India and Jammu and Kashmir on the other side. But we people in Gilgit-Baltistan and Azad Kashmir also suffer from their policy. I mean, it's not a secret that they have training camps. It's not a secret that every Friday and other day they collect money from Friday prayers. It's not a secret that they go around and intimidate and harass people. Only 2 weeks ago, my organization had a meeting, a peaceful meeting. We were not carrying guns or anything, just peaceful meeting in Ravlakot. And dozens and dozens of them came, and they asked us to, you know, go from here. They started, when our people tried to argue with them, they were, you know, tortured, and our guys had to, you know, finish their public meeting. So it is happening in Azad Kashmir, it is happening in Gilgit-Baltistan, and they are also, unfortunately, trying to purify Muslims of Pakistan, Azad Kashmir, and Gilgit-Baltistan. They think the only people who are perfect and pure are those people. So we are suffering in there as well.
Yeah, I'll just take up two quick points here about how civil society can flourish under militarized environment. I think the situation in the 1990s, early 2000s, and now, there's a complete difference between what it was then and what it is now. I think except for those three or four districts and parts of those three or four districts in southern Kashmir, rest of the Jammu and Kashmir is absolutely normal, and civil society not only is vocal, it's flourishing. In fact, that is the discourse which unfortunately doesn't get out because it helps. It's a lazy approach of the media. I've been part of the media, so I know how exactly people go. Who do they go to? They go to fix five or six people, get their views, publish their views, and just go ahead and you know, sort of focus on only the violence and the kind of discourse that is there in the southern Kashmir area. Otherwise, the civil society in the normal life in the rest of Jammu and Kashmir is absolutely normal like any other part of India. That is the reality, which doesn't really come out, unfortunately. Secondly, about social and print media, why hasn't the government thought about it? And I agree with General Hasnain that it's not the government's job. It's a beast that internationally nobody has been able to control. I mean, you look at what Twitter, the havoc Twitter sort of does, or social media platforms do in every conflict, in every situation, be it Paris, be it New Zealand, be it Jammu and Kashmir. So let's not, you know, sort of delude ourselves by saying that we could have done something in Jammu and Kashmir, because this generation is brought up on that diet. It sort of is very adept in doing what they do on social media. So yes, there are attempts to counter it, but it has to be not just all of government approach, but all of society approach. I think that's where the newspapers in Jammu and Kashmir will have to play a role. Unfortunately, they are also under pressure. They don't sort of play the role that newspapers ought to play. They are completely one-sided, and I think the army knows very well how much they suffer because of the one-sided views of the newspapers in Jammu and Kashmir. But I don't blame those editors and journalists there, because they are also under different pressure, and therefore they act the way they do or write the way they do. So therefore, there is no clear-cut or ready-made solution to that.
Thank you. We have time for the last four people to make comments or ask questions. And the order that they've raised their names, let me turn to the gentleman there first, and then followed by Aftab Siddiqui, John Elliott, and Vipul Thakur. Yes.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Usman Kiani. I am from Pakistani controlled Kashmir. And my question to the panelists is here that it has been going for last since 1947 dispute, Kashmir dispute. And it is between India and Pakistan always. It says about the bilateral issue and that they are talking about Shimla Agreement or Law Declaration. But the thing is, what I know about my history being a Kashmiri, my question to the panelists as a Kashmiri, that when it started in 47, Pakistan had taken on Kashmir, and then ruler was the Kashmir, the Maharaja.
Can we do the question, please? Because, you know, we're running out of time, and I have three
other. India took the Kashmir dispute to the United Nations. The first is the resolution in 48. That resolution is the, that was the provisional treaty between Kashmiris and the India, and the Indian army came to protect the Kashmiris. So my question to the panel is, that the last 71 years, the Kashmiris are suffering, and what the Indian government is going to do, and we are not the part of that, this
okay, thank
things. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for a very good presentation. Just Aftab Siddiqui from Innovelli Consult. Just wanted to sort of give a bit of credit back to sort of, you know, what General said and one of my fellow delegates said was, in terms of the Hindutva, I think that's typical situation which we are facing here in white supremacists. It's the same ideology. You cannot forget when Mahatma Gandhi was murdered and then coming back to 2,000 Muslims being slaughtered at Babri Mosque. So probably there is an issue there. I think it needs to be part of the re-radicalization which India may want to do by itself. Secondly, my one of the fellow delegates said that why should Indian government does not do anything in reverse, basically, you know, promote other kind of situation to create a sort of, you know, law and order situation in Pakistan. Like, so I think they are already doing it, and the credit goes to sort of, you know, Indian government. Nitin may be more aware of that. Is like, we had an attack on Chinese embassy, we have got BLA, we've got Mr. Altaf Hussain lodged here, and from his house there are documents being retrieved by the intelligence agencies here with Indian currency being given to buy weapons to destabilize Pakistan. So I think this credit kind of, you know, goes both ways, basically. So we should not kind of, you know, suffer in a bit of a sort of, you know, totally vacuum, basically. The question here is, like, we are in UK, we've seen similar kind of situation in Northern Ireland and Republic of Ireland, and there has been a model which is called Good Friday Agreement, which allowed, basically, you know, reduction of hostilities. So I would sort of, you know, like to have a comment with Honorable General also in terms of how do you think, you know, does it help? Because unless and until we discuss the core issue with the advent of fake news in this across, you know, anything can trigger a very massive issue, and we both, the I would say responsible government, should avoid that. So how do you think that can help us resolve the issue? Thank you very much.
Thank you. John Elliott.
Your question will come. Your answer. We'll answer your question.
Yes, John Elliott, journalist. I've lived in India for 25 years, and I'd always assumed that the LOC was the line that eventually most countries recognised would eventually be settled on whenever some settlement came. Yet Nitin, you, at the end of your presentation, seemed to want the whole of northern Pakistan. And later we heard about Gilgit-Baltistan as well. Surely the LOC is recognised by both sides as the line that one day will be settled on, if anything is ever settled. The general wags his head. And then, General, a question to you. I think it was you who said that there's now no insurgency. Not sure if anybody's mentioned the fact that the Pulwama attack was done by a young Kashmiri who had been radicalised, and partly because of this government's approach, militaristic approach to Kashmir, rather than trying talks and other more peaceful means. Isn't there therefore a risk of this government, the Modi government, leading Kashmir back into insurgency?
Thank you. Vipul?
Wrong questions. Wrong answer.
I, as just member Vipul Thakur, just a very brief comment. Pakistan's army does not want peace because it has got lion's shares of budget and many privileges like land, property, foreign exchange, etc. It won't give it up, and there will not be peace unless people of Pakistan realize that they are losing on social, economic, and other civilian developments. Thank you.
I'm going to give, we're coming to the end of our session, I'm going to give 2 minutes to each of our panelists to respond to the questions that have been put. And I'd like to start in the reverse order. So let me start with Nitin, then Shabir Chaudhary, and then General Hasnain. And this is 2 minutes each, and I've got a timer.
quickly, the Good Friday Agreement that you spoke about. Well, yes, I think the hostilities can be reduced. Let Pakistan stop terrorism in Jammu and Kashmir, and I think hostilities will reduce. Quick answer. Second, I think, John, you mentioned about Gilgit-Baltistan. I was talking about in the context of the whole discourse that it's a dispute between India and Pakistan, Jammu and Kashmir. If there is any dispute between India and Pakistan, it is also only about that part of Jammu and Kashmir that needs to be. Otherwise, the situation in what is called by Pakistan as Indian-controlled Jammu and Kashmir is the internal matter of the Indian government, and the Indian government will deal with what it needs to do. So therefore, there is no dispute as far as the between India and Pakistan. Therefore, Gilgit-Baltistan, as I mentioned, if at all anything needs to be discussed between India and Pakistan, it is Gilgit-Baltistan and nothing else. So you may not agree with it, but that's the thing. Pulwama, you mentioned about radicalization of the boy there. I also want to ask this question, and for 30 years I've been watching this. What is a good Kashmir policy? You just mentioned that, is this policy going to now go back to the insurgencies of 1990s and 2000s? Indian government has tried everything. It has talked to Hurriyat, it has talked to Pakistan, it has talked to civil society, it has done everything. And no solution has been found. So if that has not happened now, they were trying to do this a much harder approach. Yes, radicalization, this is to be dealt with in a way that General has mentioned, but that does not mean that India has to just be soft constantly on Jammu and Kashmir. Because if you look at what has happened in the Northeast, I think Northeast has been retrieved after a longer period of attrition in a similar manner. It's just that we don't pay attention to what happened in the Northeast. The same thing can apply here in Kashmir.
Thank you, Nitin. Perfect, within 2 minutes.
Right. I think it's wrong to say that it is India-Pakistan dispute. It's Jammu and Kashmir dispute. And Pakistan and India are parties to this. Yeah? All right. Another thing is that Usman Kiani asked about India, if they will protect people of Jammu and Kashmir because of the accession to which we regard it as provisional. I don't think they will, especially to Gilgit Baltistan and people of Azad Kashmir. So you can continue on suffering and do whatever you want to do in Gilgit Baltistan and Azad Kashmir. India is not going to come to rescue you, okay? That's one clear thing, clear. Even now my friend here said that they are only concerned about Gilgit Baltistan. No mention of Azad Kashmir, where we live.
No, that's that was only in that context of okay. Since so he mentioned Gilgit Baltistan.
The question here is, accession took place, yes, and that was for the entire state of Jammu and Kashmir. If India now decides that, okay, whatever we have, it is ours, and what Pakistan has, it is theirs, then there's a question mark whether that treaty is still valid or not, because it was for the entire JNK. And secondly, I think point was made by Pulwama that it was a local guy. Yes, of course it was a local guy. But local guy can also be radicalized. He also wants to go to heaven. Okay? And apart from that, the local guy in his video said clearly said, I am so and so and I belong to Jaish Muhammad.
Exactly.
Yeah? And also he says, when you have access to this video, I will be in heaven, inshallah. But I don't know where he is now. Only Allah knows. But so people can be radicalized even if they are in Lahore, Karachi, or in Pulwama, wherever. And these people are radicalized by who? He clearly said Jaish Muhammad. And then RDX, I'm sure there is no tree in Kashmir where RDX grows. It has come from somewhere. Training has been given to him by someone. I leave it at that.
Thank you, Shavi, sir.
So 2 minutes.
Yes, okay. Thank you.
Firstly, sir, let me start with you. The aspect of the Pakistan Army won't look for peace primarily because of its economic interest. I think Aisha is sitting here. She will answer it best. She's written about it. That thick a book she has written. Military INC, Military Inc. She'll write it, tell you. The very interesting aspect of terror and insurgency. Even the United Nations hasn't defined the meaning of the two till today. 1999, India consciously said, no longer will we call it militancy or insurgency because there are people dying for no cause. There are people just all over the place. The targeting is without any understanding of who exactly is the target. So we started calling it terror. Incidentally, sir, suicide bomber, I can tell you, day-to-day suicide bombers in Kashmir. 2001, a UK-based 16-year-old Kashmiri who came to Srinagar and blew himself up outside my headquarters, 15 Corps headquarters. That was the first one. 2004, a young Kashmiri from Sopor with a Maruti, white Maruti car who blew himself up against a bus of my division. So I can give you details of all these over a period of time. He's not the first guy. This is revisiting, which has come back. Does it mean that Mr. Modi was not in power in 2001? Nor was he in power in 2004? How is this politically linked? I don't understand. I look at it professionally, purely professionally. Don't know who was in power when. This can happen at any time. As far as LOC is concerned, sir, 1972 Shimla Agreement is very clear. It's a delineated line of control. That is about all. Nowhere does the Shimla Agreement say that this will become the basis of an agreement. At the end, the footnote says, India and Pakistan will pursue the Indian interests towards peace. That is about all. Nothing else was said about it. Northern Ireland, I visited it when I was doing the RCDS course. I think excellent model. A lot of people in India, India also have this thing about the Israeli model, the muscular policy of Israel against Palestine. I tell people these are completely different things. Yeah. You don't have a nuclear armed neighbor sitting on the other side. Does Pakistan, does Israel have that? Does UK have a problem with Ireland? Do you have a proxy war running in Northern Ireland in that manner? These are completely different situations. Last one. I've still got time. Okay. What is India doing about the UN resolution? Yeah, that was someone's question. That was a very interesting aspect. The UN resolution. So you need to do a little reading on this to understand. We pursued this right through. 65 came when Pakistan wanted to change the LOC and everything else by force. 1971 came, they wanted to change it by force. 1989 came, 1999 came. 4 times they've tried it. We have always said, now time has gone beyond. The UN resolution is no longer relevant. And 1972, Pakistan has signed on the dotted line with us. UN resolution is not relevant.
That's it.
It is for us to find peace, and through that peace, ultimately you saw 1994, India has declared that the whole of Jammu and Kashmir belongs to India.
On that, we're going to end. We're going to end this session. We've had over 1.5 hours of discussion. I know we could have gone on, but we have gone over time, and I'm very keen to stick to time as much as possible. I would just like to really thank the panelists. I'm not going to sum up the discussion or the presentation, but I'd like to thank the panelists for being here and for providing their perspectives on a very sensitive issue in the region. And as I said, I think it's been a very timely discussion that we've had for various reasons. So I'd like you all to join me in thanking the panelists for their presentation.